absolutely fantastic. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give it up for our value speakers one more time. Yeah, brilliant stuff. Now, you know what? I'm sure you've been able to gain a lot of information, a lot of knowledge, a lot of attitudes from this.
These very good people are now our hostages, and we will take them to a secret location. We'll interview
halt,
today.
Halt! Halt! Nobody talk. Nobody move. Ladies and gentlemen, it is time for somebody to take ownership of this situation.
Remain calm, you have been saved!
Covering!
Cover me!
Covering!
Stairs.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Australian Special Forces, stringently selected, meticulously trained, so that they can move on to what is arguably the most challenging and difficult workspace on the planet, the battlefield. They are equipped with the skills and the experience to go in and deal with scenarios that are life-threatening. They need to, on every occasion, they need to be able to step up and take ownership of those situations. Can you put your hands together, please, for the Australian Special Forces that came and saved the day today? Ladies and gentlemen, it's an absolute pleasure to be in front of you this morning. My name is Mark Squirrel. Squirrel as in the little animal with the big fluffy tail. But I normally go by the name Squiz. And I am going to take you all on an ownership journey. A journey that will explore what it's like to be a member of the Australian Special Forces. We will then use those skills and experiences to head overseas into a number of combat zones. But we will go there not as a soldier. We will go there as a humanitarian aid worker. And along the way, we will collect enough inspiration to then go and tackle a very, very high mountain in the Himalayas. Along the way, I will insert a number of situations that you will need to grapple and deal with that require excellence in the ownership value. In order for you to come on that journey with me this morning, I need to start by giving you some cultural awareness training. The cultural awareness training is non-negotiable, so everybody's going to be participating in it, and it is very, very participatory. The way it's going to unfold is I'm going to introduce to you three ways that people say hello to each other in some of the countries that I've been fortunate enough to visit as a humanitarian aid worker. And I'm going to do that by giving you a demonstration up here with my cultural awareness training advisor, Mr. Toby. Could you put your hands, please, together for Toby? And you guys are now going to stand up and find somebody in the room, not at your table. Find somebody who you might know them, but somebody you haven't really had a good chat to over the last couple of days. Go up and say hello to them like we do here in Australia or New Zealand. G'day and shake their hand and then look this way and we'll introduce those three ways. There's only one little caveat on it. Men need to go and find another man. Women, you need to go and find another woman. So stand up please now and find that friend. Rightio, folks. Anybody still looking for a partner? Men with men, women with women.
Men with men. Doing manly things.
That's correct. Okay, folks, if I could have your attention, please. Ladies and gentlemen, the first place we're off to is Liberia. Now, I went to Liberia last year in response to the Ebola outbreak. Now, in that particular infectious disease environment, one cannot physically touch each other because the disease was spread through bodily fluids. So the handshake was off limits. As a result of that, if we were both wearing long sleeve shirts, the other person's not fevering and they're looking pretty cool, then we would do what we call the chicken wing handshake. That is, right elbow to right elbow. There it is, you go ahead and do that with your friend. Very good, not too hard. Okay, next one, we're off to Kenya. Kenya's a place I've gone to on a number of occasions because it gives access to both Sudan and Somalia. In Kenya, people say jumbo whilst doing a regular jumbo handshake. Swing it around into one of those ones and back into a regular handshake. Go ahead and do that. Very good. A little bit of coordination required, but you've mastered it, so well done. Now, folks, we're heading into Albania. Remember the Kosovo crisis? So we're heading into Albania. People say mira dita whilst doing a regular mira handshake. Dita. And then it's really simple, three kisses on the cheek. Okay, go ahead and do that. Come on, lads, get into it. You can do it. Guys, it's three kisses on the cheek, not on the lips. Sit down, that's a disgrace.
Hey, Squiz, you're happy that I shaved for you, right?
You're I am very happy you shaved. There Thank you very much. Just three kisses on the cheek, not on the lips. What are you doing? Rightio, folks. Please grab your seats. And let's kick off that journey. So, ladies and gentlemen, I was born and bred just on the outskirts of Melbourne. Went off to Bendigo and did a Bachelor of Business whilst studying at university. Chose to join the Army Reserve and a few years later graduated at university, but also as an officer within the Australian Defence Force. A few years later, I decided then to see whether or not I had what it takes to become a member of the Australian Special Forces. Now, in the mid-1990s, Australia had two Special Forces units. We had the SAS Regiment, that's over in Perth, that still exists today. We also had a part-time commando unit, and one of their subunits is down in Williamstown, Melbourne. That's the unit that I was going for. The commandos now have a full-time unit, and that's based out of Sydney. In order to get into any of those units, one needs to undergo a very, very difficult and grueling selection course. And the selection course is designed to break the human body down into its bare basics. They want to know its true characteristics. They absolutely want to know that these people are ready to work under an enormous amount of pressure to take ownership of any given situation on that very difficult work environment that I talked about before, the battlefield. So during the selection process, the way this is achieved is that every participant is given no appreciation of what's happening more than 2 or 3 minutes down the track. We are denied access to food and sleep in any form that we are used to. So we will get the odd bit of food, we'll get the odd bit of sleep, but it'll be at absolutely wrong times of the day. But right from day one, right from the first minute, we will be physically and mentally put through the ringer. How long do you think, considering that this course goes for a minimum of 14 days, how long do you think it would take for you to start showing undesirable characteristics? I'm not hearing too much, but I reckon, would anybody like to say that they'd be out of there in 2 or 3 days? 2 days down the front, and there's a few hands over there, and you're actually pretty right, because on average, by the end of the third day, 50% of people have already self-selected. They have chosen to actually get on the bus and get out of there, and the only difference between them and those who remain, it's got nothing to do with their physical fitness. It is all to do with what's going on in their brain. They are the ones that are still standing are the ones who are truly motivated to hang in there because they want to get the golden reward, which is the Green Beret. Fortunately for me, I was still standing at the end of the 14th day, and then I was put into the category of being suitable. So just finishing it is not good enough. You still need to perform. And so what types of things are they looking for? Well, straight from your ownership value, there are three words in there that resonated immediately with me. Inside your value statement for ownership, you have highly energetic, committed, and disciplined. And as you know, disciplined is another standalone value for you as well. If I can just connect with the ownership value for a minute. Yesterday afternoon, Jim mentioned that his favourite value is ownership because he believes that it's a collection essentially of the others. And when I went back to do my homework on all of the value statements, that's exactly what I concluded today during that process as well. And so throughout this journey, you'll start to see that a lot of the other values that you've been looking at fall out in this ownership value itself. Now, in 1999, something significant happened for the Australian Defence Force. We sent a sizable deployment of troops overseas for the first time since the Vietnam days. We went to East Timor. Now, the 1st Commando Regiment that I'd been a part of now for 4 years, doing a lot of training and getting prepared for, was actually not selected. And I felt pretty bad about that, because I'd gone through this rigorous training cycle to get myself over there, and now I wasn't being given that opportunity. I'd like to give you a little insight now into what it's like to go through that training. You're about to see a video. None of it's sensitive anyway. It's us going through our training drills here in Australia. Doesn't that look like a lot of fun? I've got one hand up, sir. The selection course starts in 14 days. Start preparing yourself. Folks, it was an enormous amount of fun. But like I said before, I've done all the training and I'm ready to go. But I didn't get to go on the first rotation. The 1st Commando Regiment went subsequently. That wasn't good enough for me. I wanted to go and see whether or not I could survive inside a battlefield. So I chose to get employment with an NGO as a security officer. I got the job. And then I went back to find out what NGO stood for, because I had no idea. So NGO is a non-government organisation. These are the civilians that go in to help the civilians that are caught up in either a natural disaster or a war. And my job as a security risk manager was essentially to keep our staff safe. I would go forward and speak to belligerents on both sides as a neutral entity, and then negotiate access, humanitarian access, to the lands that they may well control, and provide analysis to my management so that they knew what I was thinking was going to be happening in the coming weeks and months with the conflict. I went over to East Timor, thoroughly enjoyed it and thought, that's it, this is what I want to do for a career. So with that same NGO, I went across to Albania, then Sudan, and then into Afghanistan, and now we're 3 years down the track. I'm having a great time. Then I applied for a job with the United Nations World Food Programme. Now, the United Nations has many different organisations that do humanitarian work. You've probably heard of UNHCR and WHO. WHO is all about medicine. UNHCR is all about refugees. WFP is not so well known, but in actual fact, it is the biggest agency within the UN umbrella. And we are all focused around food. Very, very similar, I suppose, in many regards as yourself. You are focused on the provision of food to communities. But we are going in and providing food to communities that just can't get access to the food because of the situation that's going on around them. And again, my job was essentially the same as that with the NGO. The first place that the World Food Programme sent me to was the West Bank and Gaza Strip. Oh, great. I can't wait to go there and try and tell others how to be safe. But I did. I got on with the job. And about 6 months later, I found myself at the negotiation table with the late Yasser Arafat. Now, all of you have gone through the session either this morning or yesterday, looked at sincerity. And you got the opportunity to look at many, many images and try and work out what's going on from the body language. Anybody got any idea what might be happening here? Am I flapping around in concern? Have I got a smile that's genuine, or is it sincere? Is Yasser Arafat in control? Who'd like to put the hand up to say that Yasser Arafat would be a really, really tough negotiator, and he's showing that stance right now? Oh, not too many people. You've read really, really well, because in actual fact, it's all about the context in this situation. The World Food Programme was helping the Palestinian people and the communities within the West Bank and Gaza Strip. He's the leader of those people. He opened up the doors very, very wide for us at those meetings because he wanted us to support him in his efforts to govern his people. And so in actual fact, I'm sitting there with a bit of a nervous smile, but it's a very, very comfortable environment. And I'm leading into something here, folks, because we're about to go into our first scenario where you're going to have to get to make a decision now, and you're going to have to take ownership of this particular scenario. But it's all about understanding the context. So it's very, very difficult to make a good decision under pressure if you don't have all of those variables at hand. And so we're going into the Gaza Strip now. On this particular day, I've been asked to escort some diplomats through the streets of the Gaza Strip, because I was very, very familiar with them, show them the programs of the World Food Program so that they could get an appreciation of how the good work that we are doing, and they would then continue funding those. Everything's gone very, very well. On this day, we are now only 1 kilometre away from the exit to the Gaza Strip. I have chosen to hop out of my UN-marked car, and now I'm in the back of one of their very well-marked diplomatic vehicles. So we are a convoy of three. I'm in the second vehicle. As we arrive at a particular junction that's only 1 kilometre away from where we need to get to, we come across a road blockade. Now, we have diplomatic immunity, so we have a right to manoeuvre around that. The front vehicle goes ahead, tries to do so, but the commander of the tanks puts a rifle outside of the top of the turret and shoots straight through the windscreen of our lead vehicle. Not long after that, I thought I'll take out the video camera and I'll film this, because this could be worthwhile recording. So you're going to watch the video now to see what unfolds next. And at the end of it, I'm going to ask you how you might take ownership of that situation.
This guy, you say, you know, you see tanks and all of that. Okay, okay.
This crowd is becoming quite
aggressive.
Absolutely.
I don't blame them. All of them, they wanna go home as well.
He said, you guys want to pass, and we're not going to get passed, so we're not going to prevent you from passing.
Okay, let's go to the situation anyway.
This is a very nasty situation.
We definitely don't want to go any further forward.
I think we should actually consider to go backwards. I think we should leave this area. I do not think we should...
10 meters back.
You know, this could be a riot. This could be a riot right now against us, by those people also.
Don't.
Hello?
Yeah, we should stay now. Yeah. We should stay. Tell the others
to stay.
Stop the car.
Stop the car.
Okay, folks, so it's time to make that decision. And two attributes from the ownership value are flexibility and creativity. Two things that are going to be really, really handy in you making a decision here. I'm going to give you a little bit of a helping hand. So in this situation, what would you do? A, would you wave a white flag? B, would you get out of the vehicles and run for cover? C, would you do a U-turn and attempt to leave the area? Or D, phone a friend? All right, now you're welcome to phone a friend. I don't have a problem with that. If you're going to put your hand up for that one, be careful, because I will probably be asking you who your friend is, and if you think it's Yasser Arafat, yes, you know him, but he does not control the Israeli tanks on the inside of the Gaza Strip. So have a little ponder over that. Who'd like to make a commitment? I need you all to make a commitment to one of these. Who'd like to put their hands up for waving a white flag? Probably 15 to 20% of the audience. Who'd like to get out of the vehicles and run for cover? No one. My goodness, but I hope I didn't do that. Who'd like to do a U-turn and attempt to leave the area? Well, the vast majority, I'd say that's at least 60%. Now, there must be a couple of people who are going to phone a friend. Anyone going to phone a friend? No one. Yell out if you're going to phone a friend, because I can't see any hands up. No one thinks that communication is going to help in this situation with somebody out there. Okay, folks, let's run through. You know, waving a white flag doesn't make too much difference in this scenario because we're already marked as being diplomatic. They know that we're diplomatic. Waving a white flag actually won't make any difference. Getting out of the vehicle and running away probably alarm the tank commander, and he'll get a little bit concerned as to why we are running away. So that will probably cause more troubles than what it's worth. Doing a U-turn and attempt to leave the area absolutely looks right, doesn't it? And we should have done that, but we didn't do it early enough. We should have done that about 5 minutes ago. But we've left it on the idea that maybe things will get better. And by not making a decision, it's just getting worse and worse. So unfortunately now, we can't turn around and go back because the Palestinians crowd there has already surrounded our vehicle. Yes, they've been pushed back temporarily. We try to go back through them, they're going to tip our vehicle over. They don't want us to leave. They know that we're applying more and more pressure to open this thing up to allow them to get through as well. So we've actually only got one last option there. It's all about, in this instance, communicating with the right people. And so in this instance, I was rapidly trying to communicate with the Israeli soldiers that I'd built a relationship with because that was my job. And it wasn't a matter of going to a meeting, collecting their business card, handing mine over to theirs, and then walking away. It was about getting that, but then following up weeks, months, building a relationship with them so that when I rang them in times of crisis, I was ringing them and saying, hey, it's Squizzer, and they're going, what can I do to help Squiz? Not, hi, this is Mark Skrill from the World Food Programme. You might remember me 3 months ago when we met. So building relationships is absolutely critical. And if you want to take ownership of a situation, you probably won't be able to do all of it by yourself. You've got to have people out there you can ring, you can get in contact with, and they are right behind you. But in this instance, that wasn't working because it was taking a long time for that message to get all the way back up through their chain of command and back down again. We made one phone call that had an instant impact. We rang the Swiss vehicle that had the hole in the windscreen. They'd travelled that 1 kilometre. Now they're at the border. They're at the point at which those tanks had come from. And we asked them to use the hole inside their windscreen as leverage to put pressure on the tank commander that they had immediate contact with to let the rest of our convoy through. And in actual fact, that's what was happening right at the end there. The shooting was happening. They were shooting at the ground to move the crowd away from us. And a few minutes after that, we got the hand signal to come through and we got out of there. So well done, folks. You've done well. You've survived that one. Let's head off now to Pakistan, where I'm going to ask you to deal with another situation. In this instance, I have been asked to go to Peshawar, which is a fairly large city that's inside what's called the federally administered tribal belt. That is a pocket of land that runs alongside the Afghan-Pakistan border. And on this occasion, 200,000 Pakistanis have moved from a place called the Swat Valley to the outskirts of Peshawar because the Taliban have moved in and implemented Sharia law from Afghanistan. So we are now looking, as a part of an emergency response team, to look after these 200,000 people. And at one of our camps, where we're providing the food, the distribution point manager has given me a phone call and said, Squeeze, we've got a bit of a problem. Somebody has stolen some of the foods from one of our distribution points. I've closed it. And now all of a sudden, everybody's coming out of the camp and they're thinking, rumour's gone round that we've run out of food and they're about to ransack the whole place. So I got in my car, went down there, and I got out of my vehicle, and I'm now getting a briefing from the guy who mentioned before about the distribution point manager. He's the guy who's doing the finger pointing. Can't see him at the moment because he's been covered over by that other person. He's giving me a briefing, and yeah, you're all experts in reading body language. Am I paying attention? Absolutely not. I am actively reading the body language of the crowd around me. Look at the guy who's in the light-coloured blue. He is telling me very clearly, you better make a decision. You better make that decision in my favour. I'm going to teach you a little lesson about violence. And so I say to my guy, hey, you know what, dude, I'm feeling a little bit uncomfortable here. Can we go somewhere where it's a little bit safer? And he goes, yeah, no worries, follow me. We'll go behind this big fence. Wow. Okay. Now I'm really not feeling comfortable, mainly because I'm wearing that red vest. Sort of wish I'd never worn that on that day. But I'm feeling like I'm in the zoo. And as he's continuing to tell me what's going on, you can see in the background the people are looking at me, but you look beyond that and you can see that's one of our warehouses where we're doing the distribution. People would come in from one end, we'd register them, they'd walk all the way out with a wheelbarrow, throwing in a whole lot of food commodities, go out the exit. Somebody had run in the exit, grabbed a few things and gone. That's why he'd closed it down. As he's telling me all of that, the imagery of a very, very similar situation where the decision that was made was wrong was coming back to me. And so in this instance, we very quickly move across to Guinea, where in this case, the refugees have started demonstrating by throwing stones. One of those stones lands on the head of one of their own, and he storms the warehouse with the last remaining bits of food. And most of us would look at that image and go, he's hurt, he's probably after first aid. But he's a hungry person. He's absolutely not interested in what he would say is a scratch on his head. He goes and grabs a bag of wheat flour, and he walks back out now into what previously was an aggressive crowd. But that is the trigger now to move that aggressive crowd into what we call a mob. A mob is a group of individuals who actually do start acting as individuals in the comfort that they are around others who are doing exactly the same thing. And they are doing whatever they have to do to survive. And this is an experience that very few of us understand here in Australia, because of five things that I can take away from you right now. If I took one of the five things away from you right now, you would start fighting with the person that you were shaking hands with before. Because you need five things in this life in order to sustain your own life. We know the first couple, don't we? Food, water, shelter, access to medical care, and the final one is your own safety and security. If somebody else comes in, you like those bad guys, within no time, I know a lot of you will stand up and you'll do whatever you have to do to override the situation. That's why in Syria now, we have got a rebel group. They were farmers, they were working in abattoirs, they were working in banks, but they're all fighting now. They're fighting for the right to survive. And we've all got it in us. Back in Pakistan, though, we've got to deal with a situation that's going to unfold. It's going to get really, really ugly, because I reckon in about 10 minutes, somebody's going to start throwing the stones. And so I'd ask you now, what would you do in this situation? A, would you move back into the crowd, tighten up the security arrangements, and then reopen the distribution point? B, would you request to speak with the community elders? C, would you request the local police to assist with crowd control and reopen the distribution point? Or D, evacuate the area, refer to organisational policy, and send an email with instructions to your staff? I'm going to start with that last one. Who'd like to put their hands up for D? And that's a really good answer, because over the last few days I've noticed that one thing that's really, really stood out to me about why JBS is so successful is because there is a strategic interest in making sure that bureaucracy does not get in the way of hindering the progress of this organisation. D is absolutely bureaucratic. D is something that the UN absolutely cannot get control of. When there is an option to take the easy course, we all fall back into that. And it's really, really disappointing, because if we take that option, yes, we will be safe ourselves, but the problem is our beneficiaries, the people who are in more harm's way than us, will be the ones who will lose out. And so I'm glad nobody put their hands up for that, because I would only do that if I thought that my life was under threat. Let's have a look at A, B, and C. Would you like to put their hands up for A? Move back into the crowd, tighten up the security arrangements, and reopen the distribution point. Probably 10 to 15%. Who'd like to request to speak with the community elders? Looks like there's a majority going for that one. Who's going to call in the local coppers? You're obviously from Queensland, are you? Where you trust those guys? Because we don't in Victoria. All right. Over in Pakistan, they're pretty similar to the Victorian police. They rock in, they shoot, and then they ask what happened. So you've got to be really, really careful about getting the local authorities involved in this, because yes, they will turn up, they'll use heavy-handed tactics against our beneficiaries, the ones we're trying to protect. Then they'll turn around to us and say, hey, you better pay us for that service, and we're coming back to do it again tomorrow, because clearly you haven't got control of it. So we try to avoid that as much as possible. B and A. You know what? I went for both of them. I went for B first, and then I went for A straight afterwards. So I went into a very, very quick negotiation with the community elders. That was my opportunity to make sure that the theft issue was going to be dealt with. I'm not a policeman over there. I'm not over there to try and fix up those problems. But I applied the pressure to them and said, you really need to get on top of this, because the World Food Programme won't accept it the second time. And in that moment, the crowd that was outside was relatively calm, because they knew that I was speaking with those who they trusted. But straight away went back outside, moved a couple of security guards around to the exit point, got this thing opening again, because we weren't short on food. We had enough food, we just needed to open the thing up, the crowd dispersed, and everything was okay. Well done, folks. Good effort, and thanks very much for your contributions. If we can bring that back now to the ownership value. Within that particular scenario, I look at it and I think you really do need to be committed to your results. There will always be an easier course of action, But if you think about your end goal, you've got to make a commitment to it and make sure that it happens. And you've got to really have a deep understanding of the details and understand the bigger picture of the organisation. The World Food Programme is there to help our beneficiaries. We have absolutely got to do whatever we have to do to get the job done. Doing that is very, very challenging when you're working in a war zone. One war zone that I went to that absolutely was the one that blew my mind the most was when I went to Somalia. Again, I'm working with the World Food Programme. As soon as I get out of the plane, I am told that at all times I will have two armed guards. Now, it's very, very unusual for a humanitarian aid worker to have a weapon. Well, you definitely don't carry a weapon, but to have people around you with weapons, because what it's suggesting is that we don't have the acceptance of both parties. But when we're in Somalia, we are handing out blocks of gold, metaphorically speaking. It would be like me handing out blocks of gold in this room. Everybody would come forward and they'd try to get one. So we need to have armed protection around it. I'm handing out food. It is the same thing over there. Food is gold to them. And so it's not just two armed guards when I'm mobile. When I'm moving around, going to a meeting, I'm driving in three cars looking like this. Wow. Can you imagine going to work in one of those cars with JBS? You're a pretty high-level organisation. One day you never know. You might need that level of protection. But folks, when we're in environments like this, it's very, very easy for me to look around and say, you know what? The risk here is way too high. It is way, way too high. But of course, when there's high risk, it's absolutely okay as long as it's balanced with a greater reward. And it was really, really easy for me to understand that reward. Today, on this planet, 25,000 people will die of hunger or a hunger-related disease. I could not understand that statistic if I had not seen it firsthand. Of the 25,000, the majority will die of the hunger-related diseases. These are the young women that go out and prostitute themselves to get some money to feed their wider family. They get HIV and subsequently die of AIDS. These are the young children that are forced to drink bad water. They haven't got an immune system to fight off the effects of diarrhea because they haven't had the nutrients that's required. And they die of the diarrhea. Alarming statistics. 2015, this is still happening every day. The image that you're seeing on the screen is not common, fortunately, anymore because of organisations like the World Food Programme. Famines are things of the 80s. We all know those. It's rare that that happens now. So who makes up? Who makes up these people who fit into that category of the 25,000? They come from the 1 billion people. The 1 billion people who right now are on this planet wondering whether or not today they will go to bed with that nice warm sensation inside their stomach that you've all got because you've eaten food today. They are people who are living in poverty.
Squeeze, that's me. I know what you're doing.
Thanks, Red. Go in, mate. It's through interactions with people like Fred. It's about understanding the real person, understanding their story. He hasn't done anything wrong. His family hasn't done anything wrong. It's just the situation that they find themselves in. They find themselves in poverty. They find themselves in war zones. I was absolutely becoming passionate about the World Food Programme because I wanted to do everything that I could to make sure that I made a positive contribution to overcoming issues like poverty. In 2004, the World Food Programme posted me to Nepal to provide an interface between the Maoist insurgents that were trying to topple the king. And as I went out into the foothills of the Himalayas, I had a great time looking up at those white capped peaks. I'd go back into Kathmandu and I'd meet all these climbers who were still going up into those mountains. And a lot of them would come along with the idea that they would use those mountains to raise awareness of various issues outside of the country. And I thought, hang on a second, I've done a little bit of climbing. I was really, really loving it when I was in the commandos, and I'd carried that through. I'd done a lot of rock climbing, and when I went to Nepal, I climbed a small mountain and then a big mountain. And now, all of a sudden, I get an email from my organisation, the World Food Programme, saying, we want everybody to raise awareness of global hunger on the 21st of May. And suddenly, I had a junction in my life. I had mountains, people using mountains as platforms to raise awareness. I'm being asked to raise awareness of this issue that I'm really, really passionate about because of those experiences and interactions with people like Fred. And I thought to myself, you know what? I'm not really ready to go and climb Mount Everest, but that's surely the best platform to raise awareness of this issue. And so I'm going to give it a crack. And so, folks, our journey now moves across to the biggest mountain in the world. Mount Everest stands tall at 8,848 metres above sea level. In old speak, that's 29,000 feet. The route that I chose to climb was the same as that used by Sir Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay back in 1953. As you can see here, it is going through a very, very difficult and challenging part of the mountain called the Khumbu Icefall. After that, it opens up to a nice, big, wide open valley called the Western Khum. And after that, you start climbing another 8,000 metre peak called Lhotse. You get three quarters of the way up that face, you turn left, and now we're back onto Everest, and we're inside what we call the Death Zone. The Death Zone is any elevation above 8,000 metres, and it's called the Death Zone because the human body cannot survive there for more than 3 days. You'll see that that last part of that climb is along a very, very steep ridge. It's knife edge. Most of that ridge climb will be done at night, and that's a really good thing because then you won't see what's not on the left and what's not on the right. You'll be standing then on top of the mountain, if you can get that far, and you'll probably be fairly happy, but in actual fact, you are at your most vulnerable because 80% of injuries and deaths on big mountains occur when people are just trying to get back off. They have lost their motivation and they are at their most fatigued. Now, folks, when you're climbing a big mountain, one needs to acclimatise. And the way we do that on the big mountains is that you walk up for or climb up for half a day, walk back down and rest for 2 or 3 days. In that process, you can recharge your batteries and sleep. Next time you go up half a day, you'll be feeling a lot better because you'll have more red blood cells in your system because your body has built more because it was shocked into the realisation when it was up there before. And you go another half a day, put in a set of tents, try and sleep, and then walk all the way back down to base camp again. You end up doing this zigzag up and down the mountain, which is why it takes a minimum of about 6 weeks to climb an 8,000 metre peak. Today we're going to have a little journey up Mount Everest. We'll see whether or not we can get to the top, but I'm not going to do the zigzags. Let's have a little look at the route along the way. You can see here that there are some black dots on the left-hand side of the screen. They are people who are meandering their way up the Khumbu Icefall, which is a glacier that's sliding off a very steep portion of the mountain. As a result of that, it's falling apart. And so if we zoom in a little bit closer, you can see there are big boulders. These boulders can fall and start tumbling down without any notice at all. The glacier is falling apart, and you learnt yesterday with Ian that a hole in a crevasse is called on a glacier is called a crevasse. Here I am going across one of those crevasses. We grab aluminium ladders, lay them across horizontally, and walk our way across them. But that's a little bit challenging, considering that underneath our heavy boots we've got crampons, the spikes that dig into the snow, and so we need to get familiar with this process. And so we're doing this on this slide now, back down on safe ground. I've got ice underneath me. So in this instance, I've got a training mate. He's on the other side, a climbing mate. He's on the other side. His name's Pommy. And I'm the guy who's on the ladder. As I'm going across in this instance, very, very carefully placing my feet on the rungs, you can see that I'm actually tethered to two safety lines on the other side. But Pommy, on the other side, is holding those up nice and tight just for psychological assistance. So I've got something like handrails, essentially, in my hands as I'm going across. Now, in this instance, if I fall across, it won't be a problem because I'll be able to put my foot on the ice underneath it. But it becomes a little bit more challenging when you're going across these bigger ones. Now, on this one, that's a photo that I've taken, but the first time I was going across it, I had exactly the same arrangement. Pommy was on that side, and I'm halfway across, carefully putting my feet down, thinking everything's going really, really, really well. And then all of a sudden, my arms started going like this. And when your arms start going like that, generally your feet start going like that as well. And next thing I know, I'm going to bounce off to the left. So I jumped forward, and now I'm standing alongside Pommy. Now I looked at him and immediately I saw red go voomph. Ladies and gentlemen, your climbing partner has nearly caused you to have a serious fall, and I need you to take ownership of this situation. So do you, A, ignore it but tell the expedition leader. B, laugh it off to ensure his commitment later on in the climb. C, let him know that you are disappointed and that you would like him to be more attentive. Or D, push him into the crevasse. Okay, now, I know you want to push him into the crevasse, but that's not taking ownership of the situation. So we'll drop that one straight away. Who'd like to put their hands up for A? Ignore it, but tell the expedition leader. No one's going for that one. In actual fact, it's not a bad course of action because we don't have a leadership relationship with each other. We are independent climbers on this. So by deflecting it to somebody else who has that relationship with them is not too bad. So at least B and C, who's going for B? Only a few people in the room. Every hand must now go up with C. Who's going for C? Pretty much every hand. And you know what, on paper, C is absolutely the right thing to do, and I can't say to you right now that that is the wrong thing to do. But if we connect this back now to the ownership value, two attributes that I've drawn from that is that you need to always be available and you need to set an example. And so I chose to go for B. And that's because I've got the right personality to be able to go, hey, Pommy, I can't believe you just did that. I didn't need to talk to him about it. He had that red face. He knew exactly what was going on. And in that moment, I connected with him. Connected with him, and I knew that for the rest of the climb, he was always going to come after me. He would always do whatever he could to look after me. And so I'd like to summarise that. When we're taking ownership of difficult situations, use that moment as an opportunity to build your relationships and not look for the faults in others. Use it as a solidifying opportunity. That's what great leaders do. Folks, this is what it looks like when you're so comfortable you don't need to have Pommy anymore and you can go across with a video camera in your hand. All right, folks. Now, this is what Camp 1 looks like. So we put up a whole lot of tents, and we now more or less need to be self-sufficient. So the second thing we do is grab a whole lot of snow and put it on the inside of the tent. So looking now, it's not inside the tent, but it's inside the vestibule, so the little portion outside of the actual tent. And we use that, just like Cass and Jonesy did. We throw it inside that pot, we melt it down, and we use that for rehydration and also to add to our dehydrated meals. The challenging thing we have here is a little bit cumbersome to get all your gear on and go back outside. So everybody nominates one of their water bottles as a wee bottle. And you use that, and then in the morning you go and empty that out. In the middle of the night when you get really thirsty, you've got to be very, very careful that you get your water bottle and not Pommy's wee bottle. Doesn't happen too often though because you're not that silly. Folks, moving on from Camp 1, we're in that big wide open valley called the Western Coombe. And in this part of the mountain, one needs to be very careful because of actually getting affected by heat. If there is no cloud cover, the winds are being blocked now because we're inside a very, very deep valley. If there's the rays are coming down, bouncing off the glacier below you, but the walls around you as well, it's a bit like being in a microwave. So I was warned about this and I did the Aussie thing, slip, slop, slap. Got to the other end, went to have a drink of water and realised there was something wrong with the inside of my mouth. I had burnt not only my lips but also my tongue, because I'd been walking along for 3 hours like this. So the second time I went through this portion of the mountain, I grabbed a shemagh from the Middle East and I wrapped it around my head and I looked like this. And it worked really, really well. As I was going along the trail, I came across a guy, he must have been American, and he came up to me, he's looking very, very strangely. And he said, wow, you know what? When I came away to climb Mount Everest, I never thought I'd come across a terrorist. Well, that was a culturally insensitive comment, so I pushed him into the crevasse and kept on going. So that was the first death on Mount Everest in 2006. American guy disappeared. And there we are going across another crevasse very, very comfortably. Now we've got to move on to the Lhotse face. So the Lhotse face is that other 8,000 metre peak here. And you can see the dots there who are meandering their way up there. I'm going to take a photo now and look back down. And you can see there it's very, very steep. The challenge we've got, though, is it's ice. So it's as slippery as ice, but it's as hard as concrete. So if we fall, we're in a lot of trouble. So we become very, very dependent on those ropes, mainly because if something goes wrong, we can't fly helicopters on and off at this point. So we will become very, very dependent on somebody rescuing us. And we're now 3 days' walk from base camp. There's nobody hanging around with a stretcher to put you in if you're injured. And what's even more challenging is it takes about 10 people to move that stretcher off the mountain. And there's no one up there waiting for that to happen. So if you get something wrong with you and you can't sustain it for 3 days, nothing can be done. You can't put somebody on your shoulder and walk off at these altitudes. This guy was very, very fortunate because he fell into a crevasse only 2 hours away from base camp, and he could be recovered back down where you can get a helicopter from, which is base camp. Moving up to the Lhotse face, we etched the third lot of tents in. And this is the point of no return. So we sleep at 7,200 metres above sea level. We put in the tents, sleep, go all the way back down to base camp. The second time we climb up to here, we're now going to sleep and then go all the way through to the summit. And so moving on from here, we get the additional support of supplementary oxygen. It's not like a scuba diving mask where you go underneath water and you get everything. You get a little bit of a trickle coming in. You can regulate that through a regulator. You're also bringing in ambient air from the outside. Everything's going well at this point. I arrive now at Camp 4. We're inside the death zone. We're at a place called the South Col. Jump inside the tent, still trickling away on the last bit of oxygen that's coming out of the bottle that we used to get up there, because they weigh 7 kilos, so it's not endless oxygen supplies up there. Obviously, the more you've got on, the quicker it's coming in, the quicker you're going to have to get the job done. And from this point on, I'm getting the additional assistance from a Sherpa. So I was on the budget trip. I only paid a small amount of money, $25,000, to get on the expedition, but I had to get myself to this point. Then instead of having an international guide, I had a local guide who would take me to the summit and bring me back down to here, and then I'd get myself back off the mountain. Step outside the tent at 9 o'clock at night, and I take this photo here. It's the last photo I can take all night because it is so bitterly cold. It is absolutely freezing and the camera has frozen. So I've taken one photo, I couldn't close the lens, I couldn't do anything with it. So I put that way and off we went. 3 hours into it, I started thinking to myself, this is great. I'm going really, really well. But then Murphy thought he'd come in and teach me a bit of a lesson. I'm walking along or climbing up and all of a sudden, the mask sucks in on itself. I take it off. I don't know what to do with it. I haven't climbed at these altitudes. I haven't used a mask before. The rest of the team continues going because the deal was, if we get into problems, I've got a Sherpa with me. We've all got communication with each other and we'll deal with that. So we're moving not at the pace of the slowest person. We're separating that so that we can get as many people to the top as possible. And I look at it, don't know what to do with it. Hand it over to the Sherpa. He goes, oh, no worries, I don't have to do that. Gives it a hit with his ice axe. Doesn't break the ice. But then he gives it another hit and it breaks the ice, but it also breaks the valve. Now, he wasn't doing anything wrong because this is a mask that, this is me the next day, that's got the same problem. You can see the ice build up there, and those older style masks had a metal ring to protect the valve. I'm using a new mask that's all plastic. I put the mask back on and we continue going. A couple of hours later, I find myself on the side of the mountain vomiting. I have spent everything. And I'm thinking that's it for me. I can't go any further. The Sherpa that's with me takes his mask off and he gives it to me. And I give him my dodgy mask. Now I put his mask on and suddenly then I could feel the oxygen coming back in. I feel warmth and I feel energized again. The problem was he'd eaten a lot of garlic that night. So his mask absolutely stunk. But it didn't worry me one bit. And you know what? That relationship now, we've started to bond. In actual fact, because he's got a mask that's not working so well, we're actually equalised. These guys are absolutely predispositioned to be operating at these high altitudes. And now we're actually climbing at an equilibrium. So we continue on. And at 5 o'clock in the morning, everything's just looking great. I'm looking up at the summit of the mountain thinking this is absolutely achievable as well. But the expedition leader, who remained back down in base camp, so he was away from all of the pressure of being on the mountain, communicated with us and said, you know, the others are nearly summiting. Where are you guys? We described our surroundings. He said, you're back down at the balcony. You're only one third of the distance from Camp 4 to the summit. You better get moving. I want you to increase your flow rate to a maximum I will turn off, he was going to communicate to turn off one of the bottles of oxygen on one of the Sherpas that's nearly at the summit, and we would use that one to get back off. And the Sherpas can absolutely move around at these altitudes without that. Great, we do that, we continue going. 4 hours later, I'm at this point here. The expedition leader gets in contact with us again, and he goes, Squizzer, the others have summited. They've come back to the south summit. They haven't come across you yet. That means you must be below the south summit. You're out of oxygen. He's done his calculations 4 hours later. It's time to turn around and go back. I thought, oh, you've got to be kidding me. I've spent 6 weeks on the mountain. I've spent months preparing for it. I've invested all of that money. Today's date is the 18th of May. The World Food Program had set their Fight Hunger campaign for the 21st of May. Everything was lining up because it takes 3 days to get back down off the mountain. I don't get another chance at this year. I have a look at what's going on with my regulator. The needle should have been across the left. I should have been out of oxygen. In actual fact, it was across to the right. We had made a very, very small error with a massive consequence when we were back down at the balcony. Instead of increasing the flow rate of oxygen so we could move quicker, we actually turned it the wrong way and we'd virtually turned the oxygen off. So that's good news. I've been walking for 4 hours basically without oxygen. We turn it on, now I'm feeling energized and pumped again. And I've got back in contact with the expedition leader and said, rightio, this is the situation, can you give me a bit more time? And he said, no worries, go for it. And so now I'm virtually skipping my way up to what I now recognize is not the summit of the mountain. It's the south summit, which is a false peak that denies vision access to the actual summit. So I get on the south summit and start pulling out my video camera to record the moment, thinking that maybe I won't be able to go any further. And I'm thinking, you know, this image is probably enough to convince people I've actually made it to the summit. Maybe that'll be enough. And swing around a little bit further, and now we've got the main objective, the final objective. So you can see here, if you look through the center of the screen, the route. There's a couple of climbers, and then you get a little bit further on, there's a rocky outcrop there. That's called the Hillary Step. If you zoom in a little bit closer, that is a 10-meter pitch, which back down at these elevations wouldn't be too challenging because there's lots of things to hold on. You can stick your crampons into a lot of ice there. But the challenge up there is you've got a 1,000-meter slippery slope back down to somewhere near Camp 2. So if you're lucky, you'll slide straight into your own tent. On the right-hand side, 3 kilometers vertical. Massive exposure. I didn't have time to even think about any of that because I had to get that flag to the top of the mountain. And so 1 hour after being told to turn around and go back, I find myself on top of the mountain raising the flag for the World Food Program. And on the reverse side of that flag was our Fight Hunger logo. And I spent 20 minutes on the top, pretty much just getting those photos. Because remember, we're at our most vulnerable here. And I spent that 20 minutes with Pommy. He's the guy in the red. By the time we get back down to Camp 4, which is where we're going to sleep the night, Pommy looks like this. He hasn't even recognized that one of his eyes is covered over with ice because he's so fatigued, absolutely spent. Hops inside that tent. Now, I chose to take the extra 10 minutes and the discipline to take my boots off. He grabbed his sleeping bag, unzipped it, and put it over the top of him. Now, I watched him do that, and I didn't think anything of it because our boots are heavily insulated and they're plastic on the outside to prevent any moisture from getting in. And we're wearing a down suit, so that's essentially our first layer of protection. But overnight, he was so tired, he didn't wake up with the sensation of freezing feet. And in the inside of his boots, because they were plastic, no moisture had got out and he'd sweated. So, we're inside the death zone. We've got to get ourselves back down. He arrives back down at Camp 2. The whole way down, he's using expletives I've never heard before. And when he takes his boots off, I understand why. So I hope you finished off your meal because this is probably going to turn you off a bit. He took his boots off and this is what his feet looked like. Pretty similar to Cass and Jonesy's, I think. On the reverse side, it's dead tissue. So it's ripped away. Now he had to bandage those up, get back down to base camp, and then he did. He got a helicopter out, he flew back to Pommyland. And then he sent me these images 3 months later. It's not getting any better. And on the other side, 3 weeks later, he sent me these ones. And on the reverse side, there's some good news. It's starting to repair that portion of his feet. Another 3 weeks, the body's worked out. It just can't fix some things. So eventually, it does what we all know is going to have to happen. They come off. And he ends up losing 4 half toes. And his feet now look like this. But my question to you is, has he really lost his toes? No, he's still got them, they're inside a Petri dish. So they're there, he's fine. All right, now folks, Pommy's absolutely fine. I caught up with him early this year because I went to Nepal in response to the earthquake that they had on the 25th of April this year, and he was coming back down off a mountain, so he is absolutely fine without his toes. But folks, can I just bring it back now? Around the globe on the 21st of May, as I was sliding back into base camp, we had 700,000 people walk in every time zone. And it was a great effort on behalf of the organisation to achieve its third strategic goal. Its first strategic goal is to feed people. The third strategic goal is to raise awareness of the global hunger issue. And it was very, very successful. And a very, very important component of that was my climb on Mount Everest, because it gave such a lot of publicity to it. What I didn't recognise at the time was that I had taken ownership within my organisation. So in this instance, I had looked at the bigger picture. I was turning up every day and doing a good job according to my job description, and I was getting money in return for that. But with this effort, this was something beyond that. This was looking more broadly at the organisation and how can I have a big impact on it. The way you can do it is that you can look up, maybe at your supervisor, maybe two supervisors up. Look at what they're doing and see if you can tap into that. That's really taking ownership, and it's taking leadership at the same time. Because after I'd climbed Mount Everest, my executive director, who's normally going around the globe speaking with presidents, diverted one of his flights to come and meet the guy that had gone out of his way to take ownership of the organisation's third strategic goal. I'd like you to start thinking about what you could do to have that ownership of JBS. You don't have to go and climb Mount Everest. Maybe that's completely irrelevant to the organisation. I'm going to give you 4.5 minutes to think about it, during which time you're going to reflect through vision what it was like for me to first of all work with the World Food Programme and be inspired by them to then go and climb Mount Everest.
This is a traditional Nepali school. WFP supporting this school feeding program. As you can see, each child gets a small portion of a Unilito mix, which hopefully brings them to school and allows them to get a bit of an education. We'll just have a quick look at their rooms. As you can see, dirt floors, no tables or chairs.
Walking lame.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to say thank you to JBS for inviting me to come and present to you on ownership. I hope I have allowed you to get an appreciation of what you can do to have an impact on the organisation. To finish off, I'd like to go back to where we started. We were doing some handshakes. If we could all stand up now, we're going to say goodbye like they do in Nepal. So if you stand up, look this way, look at me in the eye. Put your hands together in the prayer position. We're going to bow our heads and say namaste. Namaste. Thank you very much, folks. Good luck.